Welcome to a new test and teardown video. This video is about the Hewlett Packard 400E AC voltmeter. My previous video was about the 3400A RMS voltmeter. I just want to start this video to show those two meters side by side so you can see they are very, very similar in form and features from the outside, but they are very different on the inside. So this video is going to be about the 400E. This unit was designed in about mid 60s, 65 or something like that. And it is a few years more modern compared to the 3400. It's the same specifications, more or less. This one is not so peak pulse capable, so it's more designed for sine wave or something like that. It's just not so extreme as the other one. There isn't any fancy smancy circuits in this one, so I would believe this one is a lot cheaper. Well, we got a little bit of cool features, like external battery voltage. How about that? So you need two batteries, 55 to 50 volts plus minus. And we got DC output and AC output at the same time. And of course, nice IEC mains connector, and of course we can select between 215 mains voltage. Everything is on one circuit board. That is, of course, the power supplies we got right there, right? Input. Here is the impedance converter, or the impedance amplifier stage. Consists of this field effect transistor and another little transistor like that. The accuracy of this instrument is best in the 3 volt range. That one. Its frequency range is also up to 10 megahertz, but that is again dependent on signal level and frequencies. So if you want to measure most accurate, stay below 4 megahertz and stay in this area of level. Oh yeah, I forgot to say that. I think it's a little bit wild about those external battery voltages. It goes into a double linear power supply, and the voltage internally is plus minus 26. But of course, this is not a low drop regulator, so you need a lot of extra volts, and that is why the minimum is 35. How about that? There's a tiny little mains transformer down here, and the power consumption should be around 10 watts for this unit. There isn't any other shieldings or all those metal plates and stuff like that. It's much more simple and cheap to manufacture in all of the details. That'll be the two sections of the attenuator. This is the input BNC connector. In here you'll find two relays and some resistors and capacitors and stuff, and that is also a part of the attenuator that is driving the relays in here. I think it's just to make it a little bit better the way that they did that with relays. That is a little bit of a funny way. See, mains switch is here, and of course they take the mains power via a shielded cable, because the shielded cable goes straight through input stage. Ooh, ooh, ooh. All this should be very sensitive down here. So I expect to put on the bottom lid before we play along with this unit. There isn't any fancy choppers or thermal couplers or any funky stuff in this one. Just a regular transistor amplifiers and a meter driver. That's all there is to it. So yeah, very, very simple. I've just been playing a little bit around with this. This 1 kilohertz and 100 millivolt RMS. And we are in 0.3, so this is 0.1. So far, so good, okay? Well, I want to show you what is going on here. That is 0.2, correct. 0.3, also correct. So this is the 1 volt range, and that is 0.3, a little bit. Very close to, right? So let's just crank it up to 0.6, yeah, 0.8, yeah, 1. Okay. This is the 3 volt range, but why is it showing 1.4? So, I mean, this is 40% off, so it's completely off in the 3 volt range. And look. What happens? Mechanical stress, and that was not the case in the other ranges. I tried to move this. So is it maybe here? Oh, here we go. But I think it is weird that, see, mechanical stress in this range is a problem. But 1 volt, okay, let's just go down to 0.9. Okay, let's go down to 0.6, so it's easier to see if I'm crazy here, right? No. So something is, yeah, you see, and it has nothing to do with that connector, and there is something in here. Damn it, now I need to put that lid off again. Hey, amen. Okay, I figure this out. Now I turned this off. Yeah, it's just, can you hear it? This is the 1 volt. Here. Can you hear the relays? Right in there, they're going berserker, berserker. And now we're back to poltergeist. My point is, we got some relays right in here, and something is a loose connection when I just touch this box. So, I mean, we need to go into the relay box, the most holy there is of this unit. So what is going on in there? Okay, yeah, okay, fine. We're gonna go in there one way or the other. How is that supposed to happen? I think I maybe found a little explainer here. So what we got, the two red relays. Those are reed relays, you can see the thin wire that sticks out the end. And then there's probably some other wires that's doing the coil. And the input banana, or BNC here, goes to that capacitor. And that capacitor goes down to the PCB. So when you move around in the BNC, you move a little bit on the PCB and all that. So what are we going to move here? My idea is we're gonna move it like this so we can see what we're doing, and then we're gonna try and play a little bit here with power on. And can we hear what we're doing? Let's turn it on. And then what? What are we gonna play with here? Ooh, ooh. Ooh. Are you looking? I hope you're looking. Oh yeah, hear the relay. This is the problem. And the other one is almost as bad. Why are you having this kind of shitty connector, man? That's easy to fix, isn't it? Ha ha. Yeah. All the metal in this connector was just old and crusty. Didn't work. So I cut them and soldered them. And now, try and listen when I turn this. So that is between the 1 and 3 volt range. And there's no more funky stuff going on here. And I think this also explains why it happened in one range and not the other one, because it was that range where the relay was supposed to be energized, and then it wasn't, right? So, pretty good. So I think I'm more or less done, finally, with the HP 400E. This is 0.8 millivolt RMS from my signal generator. And as you can see here, it is working. So that was 0.8, 0.7, 0.6. And 5, oh, it's a little bit low, 0.4, a little bit low, yeah, okay, whatever. So let's go back to 1. So that is full scale in this range. So remember earlier we talked about the relays, what they're doing, right? So we got two relays in the input circuit, and that is feed through. The first relay is feed through from that everything, and then from 3 volts and up, it's the other relay that takes an attenuated signal and feed through. Okay, so now we switch over to the other attenuator, and that was my problem. Even after fixing the loose connections, this one was reading 20-30% too much. As you can see now, it is spot on. And this is because I have recalibrated this sucker here. And that was not easy, because there is no official way to calibrate the different voltage dividers. But I've, of course, figured out a way to do this. And I will show you how that works. I figured this out because of all the ranges from 3 and up. They just continue to show too much, all of them. But now they're, of course, all of them perfectly spot on. And that was because the second attenuator is what is doing all the different steps, and the two steps, that was the first attenuator. So that was the only place it could be, right? So let me show you. If we look at the input attenuator system here, we got a 10 mega ohm resistor here. This is R2, and R3 is mounted down here where you can't access it. That one goes to ground, and it should be what, 31 point yada yada kilo ohms to ground. And we got a little bit of frequency compensations and fancy smancy capacitors and stuff, but that is not my problem here at 1 kilohertz anyway. And so since this resistor is going to ground, and that is not accurate anymore for whatever reason, and I think somebody gave this a very high frequency, very high voltage, and that is a way to access this resistor via the speed up capacitor that we have here, right? Maybe I should try and show you the schematic again. So you can see that this capacitor here will be able to short circuit kind of AC wise the input directly to that capacitor, and that is a way to stress it somehow, right? So what I've done is I've just since it is impossible to access, what I've done is but it looks nice. It's not burned or anything like that. I just, maybe it's just gotten old and I don't know, whatever, right? The best way would have been to replace it with the correct one or a more smarty one, I guess. Well, what I did is, because I needed, I think it was more than 10%, I can't remember exactly the value, but I took the same percent higher value here and soldered it here. So this is the same point. As you can see, the wires go to the other one. And here's one of those capacitors, and that's also ground. So here's, I think it was 270 kilo ohms I put in here. And now all my high ranges are spot on. I had to experiment with this a few times and now it's perfectly fine. There is no other ways, by the way, to adjust this instrument. So I followed all the guidelines in the manual. I measured all the different points on all the different trimmers and adjusted all the voltage points so they're correctly. And I went up and down in the frequency range and played with the trimmers that has something to do with frequency compensation and all that kind of stuff. So now I believe this instrument is just as good as it would have been in 1969. I think there is a, yes, there is a, the serial label ends with O or starts with 09. So that means this instrument is from 1969. Now it is back to super duper fully function. So yeah, that was all I wanted to show you guys about this. Yeah, a little bit more simple, probably also a little bit more cheap compared to the other one I showed in the previous video. Clean up time here, right? Thank you for watching. Bye bye.